give it a try today and see how it works. And it may take a little adjustment because it feels like it's about to fall out of my ear as I speak, but hopefully we'll get it figured out and have something that's going to be a little bit better sound quality going forward. So bear with us as we kind of learn a new system here. Good to have all of you with us for worship this morning. Just want to call your attention to some of the announcements on your insert this morning. The deadline for the May newsletter is tomorrow morning, so please get your information into Alberta for that. Just a reminder that it's still COVID time, so there's still a great need in the food pantry for items, and there's things listed there that they are in particular need of right now. Yesterday was Love Independence Day, so if you did anything in connection with that, we'd love to know about that and publicize that in the church newsletter. Also, a thanks to all who helped either prepare the food or serve the cup dinner this past Thursday night. We had a really big crowd for it. I think
85.
85.
And we ran out of
out of food right at the very end. We had so many, so we were sorry that we ran out, but glad to be able to serve that many people. Anybody else have announcements you need to make today?
Please join me in our call to worship. It is a responsive reading found in your bulletin. God has set apart those who are faithful. Our Creator will hear us when we call.
God puts gladness in our hearts. We will lie down in safety and sleep in peace.
Beloved, we are God's children now. What we will be has not yet been revealed.
We are here to remember Jesus Christ. We want to be like the one who lived by law.
Our faith strengthens us for each day's living. God empowers our ministries of caring.
We trust God, whose children we are. We look forward to what God will reveal to us.
Please stand as you're able for our first hymn, number 664 in the hymnal, Morning Has Broken.
Turn to God that our sins may be wiped away.
We will pray together the prayer of confession printed in your bulletin, followed by a moment of silent prayer of confession. Let us pray. We are disturbed and distressed, O God, by the evil that surrounds us. It is hard to view many people we see as your children. Murderers, abusers, those who cheat others and profit at their expense. We feel like victims. Why should we confess our sins when there is so much evil beyond our influence? Yet we know we do not abide in your love. We sin by turning away from sisters and brothers who are also beloved by you, however they may differ from us. We seek forgiveness you promise and the help you offer. Amen. Forgiveness of sins is proclaimed to all who repent and seek new life in Christ. Beloved, we are accepted by God, whose will for us is a joyous freedom in Jesus Christ. Let us sing glory to God. Jesus appears to the disciples. While they were still talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and frightened, thinking they saw a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you troubled? And why do doubts rise in your minds? Look at my hands and my feet. It is I myself. Touch me and see. A ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see I have." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and feet. And while they still did not believe it, because of joy and amazement, he asked them, "Do you have anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. He said to them, "This is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms." Then he opened their minds so they could understand the scriptures. He told them, "This is what is written. The Christ will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance and forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things." And now I will continue to stay up here. I'm going to be singing Majesty. It's written by Jack Hayford and arranged by Eugene Thompson and Tom Fetke. This is a song that has a special place in my heart. Bob Hilly, our benediction, but I think it also really fits as we think about the majestic gift we have in Christ Jesus.
Everyone who sins breaks the law. In fact, sin is lawlessness. But you know that he appeared so that he might take away our sins, and in him there is no sin. No one who lives in him keeps on sinning. No one who continues to sin has either seen him or known him. Dear children, do not let anyone lead you astray. He who does not do what is right is He who does what is right is righteous, just as he is righteous. May God bless to our understanding this reading from God's holy word. And let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our redeemer. This morning I will be talking about duty. Anybody still listening? Kind of makes you long for last week when the pastor was talking about the imperfect Greek verb tense instead of duty. But yeah, duty. Duty, according to columnist John Workman, is this noble, if unpopular, word. Duty, a moral or legal obligation. It is responsibility or service to others. It is conduct due to others. Duty, responsibility, obligation, service. Heavy words, certainly guaranteed to make some people flee. But we want to say, speak to me not of duty, our fun-loving selves say. Speak to us of pleasure, of happiness, of leisure. But sometime, somewhere, someone has to speak about duty. To nominate something to duty status is to immediately start an argument. It is our duty to fight against abortion, says one group. It is our duty, says another group, to protect the inalienable right to have a voice over what happens with your own body. Another group says it is our duty to not pollute our neighbor's airspace with tobacco smoke or to keep drinking drivers off the road. While another group says it is our duty to protect personal freedoms, including those to smoke or drink. It is our duty, one group says, to guard innocent children from the ravages of pornography. It is our duty, says another group, to fight against censorship. With so many claims urged upon us as duties, we might wonder if a diverse group, like the one we have gathered here this morning, might ever agree on things that would qualify as duties. John Workman, that I mentioned before, used to be the religion editor for the Arkansas Democrat Gazette newspaper. And Workman came up with a list of seven things that he thinks Christians should consider as duties. So see what you think about his list. Duty number one, to be a faithful people in an age when keeping faith is seemingly an impossible feat. Two, to be proclaimers of hope in a time when even the saints despair. Three, to be seers of beauty and joy in a world where wonder is often crushed by human greed. Four, to be encouragers of our fellow human beings. Duty number five, to be strugglers toward love, pointers toward the way, even though one may stumble awkwardly along the path. Six, to be, however frail and unfit, keepers of dreams and custodians of vision. And duty number seven, to be bringers of light, however small, into places of darkness, however large. That's a tall order, and we might easily tire of trying to meet that list of duties. Sometimes trying to be a Christian can be almost too much. Christianity is a struggle. And sometimes we wonder if we have what it takes to climb up just one more hill. But life is a struggle, Christianity or not. Our religion teaches us what kinds of things are worth the struggle and what kinds of things are not of ultimate importance. And it gives us the resources to deal with that struggle. One of our greatest resources comes in knowing that we are children of God. In the text that I read this morning, John has this note of amazement in his voice when he says, "See what love the Father has for us, that we should be called children of God." And that is what we are. You almost expect him to add at the end of that, "Can you believe it?" We are children of God. Theologian Walter Brueggemann makes an insightful observation about what it means to be created in the image of God. He notes that we are the only creatures to whom God speaks and to whom God listens. There is friendship, companionship, dialogue. Michael Coist has a more poetic way of talking about this relationship that is so intimate. He writes this: there was a man leaving to go, I don't know where, to do I don't know what important thing in his life. But leaning toward his elderly mother as he was leaving, he kissed her tenderly. And she kissed him even more tenderly. And then, holding his face in her hands, she looked him in the eye and said, "Son, I will be with you." And then, after a long pause, she looked at him and said, "Do you believe that?" "Yes, mother," he said. And then he left. And she, with tears in her eyes, accompanied him from a distance. Sometime later, the man told me that it was like that every single time that he left, and that he was always strengthened when he faced times of difficulty to know that his mother's love went with him. And as I meditate this evening, Coist writes, "I suddenly realized, Lord, those are the words you used when you were leading us to return to the Father. I will be with you, even to the end of time. And I'm sure that you expect us to respond as that mother, or as that son responded to his mother, saying, 'Yes, we believe it.'" I love that analogy. Many of us have had the experience of leaving home, or maybe being the parent still at home when a son or daughter has left. And we know that there is a presence that remains with us even after that person has physically left. We are children of God. And God's presence is with us always, no matter where our journeys in life might take us. After making this declaration that we are children of God, John continues with the thought, saying, as children of God, we need to live like children of God. It reminds the people that Jesus came to take away their sins. He died on the cross to save us from our sins. Remember that Greek imperfect tense, an action that happened in the past with continuing effect to the present. And if we believe that, then we need to get on with the business of righteous living. Righteous living, not perfection. A number of years ago, the acclaimed series on the Civil War was rebroadcast on public television. Ken Burns, the filmmaker, was interviewed by Bob Costas, who was asking him about his impressions of some of these giants of history. Costas asked Burns, was he concerned when he found out some of the human frailties and weaknesses of Abraham Lincoln? "No," said Burns. And then he went on to say, in effect, that for him, it made Lincoln seem even more human and even that much more impressive. Because here was a man who had faults, just just like we all do, who is able to raise above those human flaws and find his own higher nature so that he might be able to promote something that was of a higher good. Burns also added that the same thing could be said of a lot of great leaders in history, like Martin Luther King Jr., a man also with many flaws, but who was able to rise above those flaws to fight for a higher good. So that's one side of the coin, that even with our flaws, sometimes we find a way to do a higher good. But Annie Dillard, in her writing about Pittsburgh's Andrew Carnegie, shows just how difficult it is to maintain that, to always be on the right side, to always be in a place where you're doing righteous living. Carnegie felt like it was that a man of wealth should give it away for the public good. He is quoted as saying, "The man who dies rich dies disgraced." So he wanted to give his money away for the public good rather than to, what he said, is make his children weak by having all that money just dumped in their laps. So Carnegie spent over $40 million to help build over 2,500 libraries around the country, known as a man of great generosity because of that. But at the same time that that was happening, a steelworker, speaking for many, told an interviewer, "We did not want him to build us a library. We would have rather had higher wages." Steelworkers in those days worked a 12-hour shift on floors so hot that they had to nail wooden platforms under their shoes. They would work that way for a couple of weeks, and then at the end of a two-week period, they had to work an inhuman 24-hour shift before they were given their one day off. Their wages were so low that their only housing that they could afford was crowded and filthy. Most of them died in their 40s or younger of either some kind of accident or disease. So here is this man had this great reputation for generosity, but also had the most deplorable working conditions for the people who worked under him that helped him make that fortune. It is quite a challenge to live as children of God all the time, day by day, hour by hour, moment by moment. No one ever reaches 100% of our human potential. But the challenge to live as much of our lives as possible as true children of God is made easier, not made easy, but made easier by knowing that God is for us and with us. And with God so fully and unconditionally loving of us, is it anything less than a duty for us to respond fully in kind? Amen. Our hymn is number 729 in your hymnals. "Lord, I want to be a Christian," and those who are able, we invite to stand and sing.
Amen.
text for you to sign today, a sympathy card to the family of Bob Wesley. Thank you card to all the dispatchers at the Independence Police Department. And also a thank you card for all they do for Independence to Bev and Joe Smith. And then on our prayer card for today, a couple of updates to give to you and some additions. And Donna, I've forgotten your nephew's first name.
Greg.
Greg Taylor had a heart attack and had a stent put in. Is recuperating well from that, but asked for prayers for Greg. And then found out that Dave and Susan Hill's daughter, Carrie, died this past week. So our sympathy goes out to Dave and Susan. Our church secretary, Alberta, her grandson, Devin, has been having a lot of problems with kind of abdominal colon type issues, and it wound him up in the hospital in Tulsa this week for a few days. And so I'm not sure if he's back home yet or not, but they're trying to figure out what's going on with him. So keep Devin in your prayers. And then also Sue Landwehr was down in Oklahoma getting ready for a wedding and tripped and fell and broke her hip and is recuperating from that after surgery. So any other updates or new people that we need to add? Okay, let us all then come before God in prayer. O God of Abraham and Sarah, our ancestors in faith, by your grace we have been made with them a part of your family. You call us your children, and so we are. You watch over our coming and going. You nurture our growth with sustaining wisdom. You send your Spirit as a guide for our wanderings and give the promise of Christ's redeeming love to rescue us from waywardness. We thank you for the innocence of children and their trusting natures. Teach us that same love and trust as we look to you for aid. Their dependence leaves them vulnerable to those in whose care they are placed. May they remind us of the obedience of Christ to the one who sent him into the world. Help our children teach us what it means to be dependent on one another, and give us some measure of their humility as we seek to be faithful. We thank you for curiosity that leads to learning, for the willingness to move beyond what is already known. Use the spirit of inquiry to prod us out of complacency and make us impatient to know more of your truth. By the gift of your spirit, give us an insatiable longing to see your will accomplished. Guide us to the scriptures in search of wisdom, and give us the discipline to pursue the quest. We thank you for the trials that test our allegiance and brokenness within that is the prelude to new growth. When we shy away from suffering, confront us with the courage of Jesus, who endured on our behalf. When we avoid sacrifice, chasten us with your judgment, and fill us anew with zeal for your righteousness. You have called us your children and made us members of your household. Help us to grow as faithful brothers and sisters in response to your trust. We pray today especially for Dave and Susan and their family and the loss of their daughter, for Greg, for Sylvia, Savannah, Devin, Mary Beth, Jesse, Joan, Dennis, Connie, Sue, Bev, Maxine, Mary Ann, Art and Laverne, Lucinda, Jennifer, Carolyn, and John. And from our church family today, we especially keep in our prayers Matt, Diane, Emma, Caitlin, and Tyler. All of these things we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. During this time of offering of ourselves, we remember the words in the book of Acts. Remember the words of the Lord Jesus. It is more blessed to give than to receive. Let us think about ways in which we may give to others.
Thank you.
Love the Lord your God with all of your heart and all of your soul and all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. And now may the God of peace make you holy in every way, and keep your whole being, spirit, soul, and body, free from every fault at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ.